And good morning, everyone, and happy Father's Day to our fathers today, and happy Father's Day to any joining us by live stream. We honor you, we appreciate you on this, your Father's Day. Amen. Amen. Now, I probably shouldn't say this out loud, but I'm going to. I saw this meme today for all of our fathers, both on live stream and here. It showed this row of mothers pushing strollers, okay? And it said, hey, if she can push a stroller, she can push a lawnmower. You guys take it easy today. Anyway, all right. All right. Thank you that we can enjoy your presence. We can enjoy our fellowship one with another. We can have fun in your presence. Lord, in your presence there is fullness of joy. And so we thank you for that. We ask that you would just come into our midst today, that you would bless this service, bless this time today. May your name be uplifted and honored. May your praises be sung. And Father, we just ask that you would help us to worship you today. Lord, your word says in this New Testament covenant dispensation of grace that your people worship you in spirit and in truth. We give you thanks for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you. pay him a little more.
Yeah.
with you. You are worthy to be praised and adored. We lift your praise up to you, Father. Hallelujah. We just give you thanks and praise. We say we love you, Lord. We declare that. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Glory be to you. Glory be to you.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You may be seated in his presence if you're not. Hallelujah.
Well, then, may I say a prayer?
Pardon me?
May I say a prayer for us?
Go ahead.
Dear Father, it is your day today. I pray, Lord Father, that in this little place, you are glorified, that we live in such a way that you pour out your spirit, pour out your gifts, that we would be receiving children for what you have for us, and that we give it back and say, look what our Father has done for us, that we may truly glorify you, that there is no lack in your children, that it is seen we are loved, we are forgiven, and we walk in that authority and that power and that grace. And that we bestow this to others, that you may be glorified and others may be drawn in. By you this day, Father,
thank
we
you,
come
Lord.
Receiving to give back in Jesus' mighty, holy, holy name. Let us receive.
Hallelujah. Amen. We set ourselves in agreement. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Well, anyone that have a word of testimony today, you want to lift up the praise of the Lord, Brother Allen, go ahead.
When I was yesterday and maybe the day before, I downloaded a TV show that had John Denver in it, and I started to listen to the show, and it talked about him. And I noticed that he had such energy and he loved people. But if you read Romans chapter 1, it talks about worshiping the creature instead of the creator.
Right.
And he really loved nature. And I thought for a while and I thought, you know, he worships really hard, almost like some spiritual godly people worship the Lord.
Yep.
And people think, oh, because it's so mellow and it's so good and the words aren't offending too much, that makes it clean and okay.
Right.
But you know, Bob Dylan, didn't he sing a song about something about everybody worships somebody or something?
You gotta serve somebody.
Right, that's it. And I realized that if you ever wonder what an angel of light is, John Denver was worshiping what he thought was good, but it was an angel of light. It was a demonic force. And I'm not saying listen to his music conjures up demons.
No.
But what I'm getting at is, he had what Christians need when it comes to determination and energy and love,
passion.
Even though his wasn't actual love.
Right.
But what I'm getting at is I realize that we need to worship God like he worshiped nature.
Yeah.
Passionate
worship, right. Amen. And that's the truth. And yes, you know, I pray that, you know, at one time he said he would never receive Christ. I pray his last moments before he died, you know, we don't know what happened, so we can just say that the judge of all the earth will do right. You know, that's all we can do. But anyway, anybody else with a...
I have a testimony.
Hang on just a second. She's got one here.
This morning, being Father's Day, we got to thinking about our children, and our one son called Lemuel. He called
texted.
Or texted. Mm-hmm. The most beautiful note to his dad. Wow. And then our son Jim, he texted.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But it just touched my heart that our family loves their mom and dad like they do. Mm-hmm. And we're so blessed, so very blessed to have children that are good people.
Amen.
And that love their family.
Amen. That's a blessing. Tara?
I went and had some things checked out with the doctor. I know, mm-hmm. unusual. Very. And turns out that I don't have cancer. And they're
Lord,
just
good.
Lumps, and they're benign. They're sitting next to the lymph nodes. And that I don't have to worry. They're not going to be growing. And that they're just fibrous tissues.
Praise the Lord.
And I'm very thankful for that.
Amen. Amen, sister. Praise the Lord. We rejoice with you. Anyone else with a praise report or a prayer request?
I have a prayer request.
Go ahead, Mary.
There is a local pastor that is resigning here in Boone, so we need to lift him up in prayer with his new journey ahead of him and the church.
Amen. All right. Praise the Lord. It's not me, so it's okay.
You're standing there.
Well, I got it. No way. Go ahead.
Noah had some surgeries, and the pathology was great. And by looking, we were told that he might have to have some reconstructive surgery on his lip after, like, down the road a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
But by looking at it, it looks really good.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Awesome.
He's doing good.
We believe for a speedy and full recovery for our good buddy Noah. Amen.
And we cast Williams down to the ground underneath our
yes,
feet.
Yes,
no more
yes,
symptoms.
Yes.
That he would be set free from Williams.
Yes, yes. James?
Just keep him on in prayer. Her and my brother are traveling today to Houston to MDX.
All right, brother. All right. We sure will. Sure will. Amen. All right. Anybody else with a prayer? Go ahead, Nancy.
And his family are in Cabo, Mexico, and they're traveling to some little towns there, mm-hmm. so I pray for their safety.
Yes. Yes. And that's your son, you said, Trevor? All right. We will pray for him and his family. That's, it's a beautiful area, but it is fraught with some danger, so we'll believe the Lord for their protection. So. Amen. Yes.
I want to pray for Kevin, her husband.
Yep.
Even though he's got a real good report, we want to keep praying.
Yes. Yes.
And thanking the Lord for his healing power.
Amen. Amen. All right. We want to pray and believe God. Anybody else with a praise report or a testimony or a prayer request? Pardon me.
Continue to pray for my scalp that this condition is finally healed once and for all, that
yes.
I don't have to fight with people, and it's been really bad, and I need my hair, it's biblical, I need my
it
hair.
It is, yeah, I mean,
do not look good without hair.
In my case, my diminishing hair on top, that's one thing, but it does look worse on a woman, I admit, it does.
And it's a curse, so we just reverse the curse and Satan
yeah.
will not have any more, and I get, again, sevenfold back.
Amen.
With the enemy
Amen.
Stealing, and that my scalp, this has been a big deal, it's been going
yep.
on for a year.
It has, yep.
So we just pray for the healing.
Well, let's believe the Lord for it, Tara. Amen. Anybody else real quick before we pray? All right, let's pray. Father, I thank you, Lord, that you are a good God. You are a good Father. We give you praise for it, Father, today. Lord, we rejoice with those who do rejoice today. Lord, we just lift up Kevin Anderson to you. You
yes.
work in his body. We pray for Jeb and his family as they're traveling down in Cabo there in that area, Lord, that your protection would be on them. We plead the blood of Jesus in the name of Jesus over them as they travel from town to town and village to village, Lord, that you will go before them. Your angels, Lord, would travel with them and keep them safe. Lord, we lift up James's mother and his brother, Lord, as they travel. Lord, we ask you continue to work in her body in this situation. Lord, we pray for this church and the pastor that's resigning. Lord, we pray for him on his next leg of his journey, Father. We pray for that church. We pray that it would prosper. We pray, Lord, that it would be blessed. Lord, that they would get, Lord, that every need they have would be met according to your riches and glory. We thank you, Lord, that you are working, Lord, in Noah's body. We believe you, Father, for a full and complete recovery for him. Lord, we lift up Tara. Lord, we just pray for a healing touch in her body. Lord, we just take authority over this issue in her scalp. We just tell it to go from her in Jesus' name and for restoration to come, this torment that has been there, just to go from her in Jesus' name. We thank you for it. And Father, we lift up these requests to you today. Lord, you know in every ear. If I miss something, Lord, you know what it is. And Lord, we just give it to you. We just give your people to you. And we just praise you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Well, we want to worship the Lord with our giving. We are at, it's hard to believe, we're at third Sunday already. I mean, June, well, all the months have just gone by so quickly. But anyway, this is building expenses. Anything not designated tithe or otherwise is building expenses for the third Sunday. And so keep that in mind in your giving today. And we're going to have the sisters play for us like they normally do, and we're going to worship the Lord with our giving today. Amen. Praise the Lord. Church on Saturday, July 1st at 2 p.m. Now, if you are a believer and you have never been baptized in water, we invite you to join us on that day. We've got at least one young man. I think we're going to have some others that are baptized that day as well. But if you've never been baptized in water as a believer, we invite you to come that day at 2 o'clock, E-Free Church here in town. And, you know, follow the Lord in believers' baptism. Amen. Baptism's for believers. And so let's be noticing that. All right. In your bulletin, they're under church news. All right. Praise the Lord. If you want to be baptized that day, if you've never been baptized, see me about that, and we'll get you taken care of. Amen. All right. Well, let's take up our Bibles on this Father's Day. Hallelujah. Take up our Bibles and pick them up here. I'm going to wave mine around a little bit. Make the devil mad and Jesus glad. The devil doesn't like to see people holding their Bibles up. Guess what? We're going to do it anyway. Amen. And say this after me. This is the Word of God.
This is the Word of God.
The Word is a lamp unto my feet.
The Word is a lamp unto my feet.
And a light unto my path.
And a light unto my path.
I receive the light.
I receive the light.
I believe the Word of God.
I believe the Word of God.
Because it is impossible.
Because it is impossible.
For God to lie.
For God to lie.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen.
Well, you know, today is Father's Day. This is a day traditionally set aside on the third Sunday of June to honor our fathers, fatherhood, the paternal bond, and the influence of fathers in society. Many of us can look to the influence our fathers had in our lives and reflect on the memories that we have. Now, some of those are positive. Some of those are not so positive. Mm-hmm. Our fathers and father figures in our lives taught us many things about life and living. And you know, of course, that Scripture commands us to honor our fathers and mothers. So like Mother's Day, Father's Day, while not a biblical holiday, certainly helps us to obey the commandment to honor our fathers. Many can look to their fathers today as godly influences in their lives. But there really is no greater example of fatherhood than God, our Heavenly Father.
Amen.
Those of us who are fathers, we look to Him and we want to pattern our fatherhood after the Father. Amen. Now we get acquainted with and learn about our Heavenly Father in His Word. Turn with me today to Psalm 103. Now, this is a psalm that one of our worship songs is based on, the first part anyway. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all His benefits. And of course, it lists those benefits. We're familiar with that part of the psalm, but we're going to come down a little farther into it. We're going to come down there to verse 8. And we're going to look at verses 8 through 14. In those verses, we learn some things about our Father. And I got to tell you, what a Father He is. Amen.
Amen.
Verse 8 says this: The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and plenteous in mercy. He will not always chide, neither will He keep His anger forever. He hath not dealt with us after our sins, nor rewarded us according to our iniquities. For as the heaven is high above the earth, so great is His mercy toward them that fear Him. As far as the east is from the west, so far hath He removed our transgressions from us. Like as a father pitieth his children, so the Lord pitieth them that fear Him. For He knoweth our frame, He remembereth that we are dust. Hallelujah. First thing I want you to notice in those verses is the slowness of Father's anger. Didn't He say there in verse 8, the Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and plenteous in mercy? It told us that He'll not always chide, neither will He keep His anger forever. I tell you, as earthly fathers, and I don't know, maybe this is just me, I don't know, but as earthly fathers, sometimes our anger is not as slow as it should be or as we would like. We can get angry. We can get, you know, angry with our children. I don't know if those of you that have raised children, if they ever tried your patience. I don't know. It may have just been a situation in our house. That may not be a widespread thing, but in our house, sometimes they could try our patience. And sometimes my anger wasn't as slow as it should have been. And I got to tell you, again, maybe this is just me. Sometimes fathers are given, talking about earthly fathers, sometimes we are given to overreacting.
No, I
got to tell you, especially when they were teenagers. I can remember, and I'm not saying I'm proud of this, but one day I found out that our daughter had told me that she was one place and was actually another place. Okay? She had told me she was going to be at one place and was actually another place. And so, overreacting, I drive out to this place where I thought she was, where I was told she was at. And I get out of the car, and the father there of this other girl, he started saying something to me, and I jumped out of the car, and I may or may not have gotten in his face. I may or may not have. And I may have put my nose right on his nose. And I may have said, "You better tell me where my daughter is, and you better tell me now, Hoss." Overreacting. But anyway, our Heavenly Father doesn't do that. Now, our Heavenly Father is merciful. Aren't you glad He is? And merciful translates that Hebrew word rahum, and it appears 13 times in the King James Version. And in every case, refers to God, with one possible exception. All the rest of them we know refer to God. And the best definition of the word is compassionate. Aren't you glad that our Father is compassionate? You know, Jesus, He said that He came doing what He saw the Father doing. I find that fascinating. Because the Bible says that Jesus, more than once, was moved with compassion. He was moved with compassion and fed the hungry. He was moved with compassion and He healed the sick. I mean, compassion, when you have compassion, it motivates you, it moves you, it pulls something out of you, and you want to reach out and do something about the situation that you're looking at. Well, I got to tell you, our Father is compassionate.
Amen.
Hallelujah. He's also gracious.
Yes.
Oh, I'm so glad that He is. I'm so glad that He reaches out to me in grace, because I don't know about you, but I need plenty of grace. I don't know about you, but I need plenty of grace from the Father. I need His grace. I need His mercy, and I'm glad He's got a lot of it. Amen.
Amen.
Well, listen to this now. Our Father not only is slow to anger, but if He does become angry, He doesn't hold the anger. He doesn't hold the anger. And I don't know about you, but I'm glad our Father is a forgiving and a restoring Father. I don't know if any of you have ever really blown it or really made mistakes or really, I mean, just blew. You know what I mean? You know what that is? Just blew. And I'm so glad that my Heavenly Father is a forgiving and restoring Father. Aren't you glad? Hey, the Bible says in 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, He's talking about His kids there, huh? He says, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just, oh, watch this, to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Now, that's not a picture of a father. I don't know what it is. Amen. Hey, you know, it's one thing to forgive. Your child goes out and they have their brand new Easter clothes on, let's say. They're brand new. You just bought them. And you spent quite a bit for them. And they decide to go out and make mud pies or play in the mud. And they're all muddy. And those clothes are muddy. Well, you pick them up. You pick them up, and they're crying because they know you're going to be upset with them, but you take them in your loving arms, and you comfort them. You say, that's okay, honey. We'll get you cleaned up. We'll get your clothes washed. And you take them, and you forgive them. But I guess what? If you didn't put them in the bathtub, they would still have mud all over them.
Yeah.
Aren't you glad that our Father not only forgives, but He doesn't leave the mud on us of our mistakes, of our blunders, of our sin, but He takes us by the blood of Jesus and cleanses it too.
Amen.
Amen. Oh, listen, we got to see the strength of Father's mercy here too, verses 10 and 11. He said, He had not dealt with us after our sins, nor rewarded us according to our iniquities. Watch this. For as the heaven is high above the earth, so great is His mercy toward them that fear Him. Oh, aren't you glad? Aren't you glad? Listen, His love for us and our relationship with Him is not based on our sin. In other words, He has not dealt with us after our sins, nor has He rewarded us according to our iniquity. No, when we get what we don't deserve, listen, or when we don't, let me say that another way. When we don't get what we deserve, that's God's mercy. Amen. Maybe you know every one of us deserves hell.
Yeah.
And maybe you know, every one of us deserved to be separated from God for all eternity. But God in His mercy, hallelujah, He extends that mercy to us, and we don't get what we deserve. Listen, that is God's mercy. Now, He says, for as the heaven is high above the earth. I want you to know we're dealing with something that is not measurable here. Not measurable. It's higher than the heaven. And literally, the literal there would be like the height of the heaven. Now, you might be able to, I don't know how they would do this exactly, but I'm sure there's a way. You might be able to start from ground level at some place. And you might be able to measure how high or where the atmosphere of our planet starts from above the earth. You might be able to measure how high that is, maybe, depending on where you were at. But see, this isn't what this is talking about. Because this is the definite article. So when he says, as the heaven is high above the earth, he's talking about the dwelling place of God. Listen, you cannot measure how far it is from earth to heaven. We don't know how far that is. And of all of the wonderful discoveries in telescope technology and all of the wonderful things they've seen out there in outer space, not one of them yet has seen heaven. Not one of them has gotten so far out there in the vastness of outer space that it saw beyond the farthest galaxy. And wherever that is, and I got to tell you, the universe is ever expanding, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
We know that. And so wherever that is, from the farthest galaxy out there, wherever that is, somewhere out there, there's heaven. And the Bible says, as the heaven is high above the earth, a distance we can't measure, He says, as the heaven is high above the earth, check this out, so great is His mercy toward them that fear Him. Now, mercy, oh, what a word mercy is. Mercy is that word hesed in Hebrew, hesed. And it's difficult to translate, and I got to tell you, it usually is translated wrong. Now, I'm not fussing at anybody's translation. That wasn't my point. I'm not fussing at the translators. You know why? Because hesed, that Hebrew word, is a word that is very difficult to translate in any language. Why? Well, because it combines the thoughts of love, generosity, and enduring commitment into one word. It combines the thoughts of love, generosity, and enduring commitment all in one word, and they call it chesed. Hallelujah. Now, one of the best ways to describe it is loyal love. Now, in loyal love, mercy, God does not reach out to us and love us and care for us and provide for us because of our worth. He doesn't say, you know what? There is something so, and I know there's some preachers that preach this, but it's just not true. God didn't look at us and say, you know, there is something just in you inherently so good that I love you and I'm going to reach out of my mercy because you are worth so much. Hey, listen. God does not deal with us and provide for us and love us because of our worth, but in his chesed, in his mercy, watch this. God reaches out. Chesed is where God reaches out to us in love and faithfulness, not because of our worth, but because of his character and his commitment to his promise. Listen, his character is mercy. Pardon me. His character is mercy. That's his character. And so he reaches out to us because of his character. But not only that, there's a matter of covenant here. There's a matter of covenant. There's a matter of his word. So because of his character and his commitment to his promise, he extends to us this thing called chesed or mercy. Woo! The strength of the Father's mercy, I'm telling you. Oh, but watch this. We look at the scope of Father's forgiveness. Verses 12 and 13 told us something about that. It says, as far as the east is from the west, so far hath he removed our transgressions from us. Like as a father, check it out, pitieth his children, so the Lord pitieth them that fear him. Hallelujah. Oh, I'm telling you, I'm glad that the Father has removed our sins as far as the east is from the west. You know why? Because that is an infinite line. I can tell you how far it is from north to south in any direction, in any part of the place you want to go to. You can measure how far north is from south. So if he said he had removed our sins from us as far as the north is from the south, hey, there would have been a danger. Somebody could have gone far enough south and found those sins. Huh? Yeah, the devil could have gone, yeah, he could have been going down to Georgia looking for a soul to steal. Looking for another dumb hillbilly with a fiddle that he could get into a contest with. Now, if you're not familiar with that song, if you're too spiritual for that, I can't help you. But I'm telling you, he might have been going down there to have another fiddle contest with another guy named Johnny, and he might have been down there so far south that he found all your sins. But oh no, but the Father, hey, he removed your sins as far as the east is from the west. I can't tell you how far it is from the east to the west. Why? Because that just keeps on going. That's an infinite line. That means those sins are gone and they're not going to come back and they're not going to be found by anyone, including the devil.
Amen.
Woo, hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. You may, listen now, you may remember your sins. Come on. Others may try and remind you of your sins. But I want you to know the Father removes your sins. Woo, hallelujah. Hallelujah. And watch this. Watch this. He says, as a father pitieth his children. Now, pitieth there really doesn't mean to pity, but it is to love and have mercy for. It is to deeply love and have mercy for. I don't know about you, but I deeply love my children. I deeply love my children. And I want you to know, if they hurt, I hurt. And sometimes they hurt, and I feel like I might hurt worse than they hurt. Because sometimes they've dealt with their hurt, and I still hurt because I knew they hurt.
Yeah.
Huh? Yep. If they hurt, I hurt.
All seven of them.
That's right, all seven. And that's a lot of hurt to carry if they hurt. Just hope they don't hurt all at once. Woo! Now, if they need something, watch this. I want to reach out and meet that need. Come on.
Yes.
I don't care if it's 3 o'clock. It was late one night, and our daughter Emily messaged me, and she said her basement was leaky, had water in her basement. And I said, "Hey, I'll come over right now if you need some help." No. That's anyway. I would have done it though, even if it was late. Amen. See, if they're in danger, watch this. I want to come to their rescue or their aid. Come on. But oh, listen. That is how your heavenly Father is. Many times over.
Yes.
The Bible says, as a father pitieth his children. In other words, as he deeply loves and has mercy for, so the Lord pities them that fear him. So he deeply loves and has mercy for those who fear him. Listen, if you hurt, you have a merciful high priest in Jesus. If you hurt, the Bible says he is touched with the feeling of your infirmities. If you hurt, Jesus hurts. Hey, if you are in danger, your Father wants to come to your aid and to your rescue. If you have a need, your Father wants to reach out and meet that need. Why? Because as a father pitieth or deeply loves his children, so the Lord deeply loves and has mercy for those who fear him.
Amen.
Wow. Oh, but listen. There's one more. I got to get out here. The security of Father's knowledge. The security of Father's knowledge. Look at verse 14 there of that text we looked at. For he knoweth our frame. He remembereth that we are dust. Yeah. Well, let's look at that real quick. You can be assured your heavenly Father knows you. You know, we talk sometimes about people, you know, and sometimes when kids are growing up, they get to a place, they get to an age, I don't know if you remember this or know this, but they get to a place where we as parents get extremely stupid. They get to a place where they have arrived at superior knowledge, and we are really stupid, and we don't get them, we don't get what they're dealing with, we don't get their world, we don't get their seeing man, we don't get it. But I got to tell you something. Your Father, he gets you. He gets you. He knows you. And I got to tell you, knoweth in the King James Version translates the Hebrew yada. Yada. And it is to know intimately and to know completely.
Amen.
He says he knoweth. And in this context, I check this out. In this context, yada is to know by observation. He knows you because he's always watching over you.
Yes.
He knows what makes you tick. He knows the hurts you have. He knows the struggles you're facing. He knows the things you're dealing with. He knows you completely and intimately because he's always watching you. He knows you by observation. He knows you inside and out, backward and forward, up and down. He knows you. But he says he remembers our frame. Frame there translates the Hebrew yetzer. Yetzer, it speaks of our form, it speaks of our frame, or it speaks of our framework. In other words, he knows how we are made because he made us. I like what it said there, that he remembers that we are dust. I remember hearing a story one time of a little girl who was sitting in a church service. And the pastor is waxing eloquent, and he is pontificating, and he is praying in a very erudite and scholarly manner. He's beseeching the Father in heaven, and he says, "Oh God, remember that we are but dust. Remember, Lord, that we are but dust." The little girl sitting there really rather puzzled. And she leans over to her mommy. She says, "Mommy, what's butt dust?"
Oh.
But yeah. He remembers we're dust.
Yeah.
This Hebrew word, though, speaks either of dry ground, it speaks of dry earth, it speaks of mud if it's wet. The first man, Adam, Adam, the Bible says he was formed of the dust of the ground. Now, he was just a lump of clay until the Bible says that God breathed his spirit into Adam. He breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And the Bible says Adam became a living soul, or as it says over there in the Talmud, a speaking spirit.
Amen.
Adam became that. And you see, he remembers our frame. Isn't it interesting that a lot of times when we're standing at a graveside, a lot of times, you know, when I am saying a few words that we're having the committal service at the graveside, a lot of times you'll say dust to dust, ashes to ashes, you know, all of that. Why is that? Well, because man's body, check this out, human beings' bodies return to what it was made from originally when the spirit departs at death.
Yeah.
See, we talked about that last time. There's a departure of the spirit from the body. And the Bible says in James 2:26 that the body without the spirit is dead. And so when the spirit departs the body, then that body in the ground begins to go through a process of breaking down and being decomposed. And in all that, I've had people ask me, "Pastor Kevin, what about cremation?" You know, a lot of people are cremated these days. And the reason for that mainly is the fact, I don't know if you knew this, but funerals cost a lot of money.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, time you buy a casket, time you buy a vault, because the state of Iowa, you have to have a vault to put that casket in the ground, a steel vault. So the time you get all that, and you pay the funeral director and all the stuff that the funeral director, it's a lot of money. So a lot of people have opted these days to be cremated. And it's a little different when you do a funeral when there's been a cremation, because normally, you know, there's a casket and, you know, you've got all that. But at a cremation, they usually just bring this urn in and they set it there. It's got flowers around it, people have sent, and, you know, maybe pictures of the departed. But the point is, I've had people ask me, "Well, Pastor Kevin, what about cremation? You know, is that biblical? Should we be cremated?" And I say, "You know what? What happens when a person is cremated is their body, the minerals in their body are reduced to a bunch of ashes that they put in that urn." Yeah. And so guess what? They just sped up the process of what happens if you put them in the ground. They become dust, they become ashes. And I want you to know that the same God who took man from, took a bunch of dust in the case of Adam, and took dust, and out of that dust, out of that mud, if you will, out of that earth, formed man and breathed into his nostrils. Listen, the same God who did that in the originally can reconstruct, can recompose dust and ashes and all of that that's in the ground and raise that person up. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
That's right. So that's what I always tell people. But listen, man's body, though, returns to what it was made from originally. But see, the Bible says the Lord knows that we're dust. Now, you know the nature of dust. It doesn't really have any substance. It doesn't have any strength. You know, I heard somebody say here a while back, they said, you know, the Bible says that God made man from the dust of the earth. And the Bible says to dust he'll return. And they said, that's why I don't dust, because it might be somebody I know. Huh? Amen. Stories told about a little girl. She said, she's looking under her bed one day. She comes to her mommy just all upset. And she says, her mommy says, what's wrong, honey? She says, I looked under my bed. And she says, didn't you say that man came from the dust of the ground and to dust he'll return? Yeah. Yeah. She says, I looked under my bed. And somebody's either coming or going. Yeah. Anyway, not talking about dust. It doesn't have much substance to it. It kind of flies around. Doesn't have any substance. You just take a pile of dirt. Doesn't have much substance to it. And the Bible says that our Father knows we are dust.
He knows our frame.
Knows our frame. Knows how we're made. Knows how it makes us tick. Yeah. Now, thank God for the slowness of Father's anger, the strength of Father's mercy, the scope of Father's forgiveness, and the security of Father's knowledge. Like I said at the beginning, what a Father. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for these things that we could look in the Word today and learn of you, learn about you, learn of your mercy, learn of your grace, learn of your love for us and the extent of it. And Father, I pray that you would take this word that we have proclaimed today. Now, Lord, we don't do it perfectly, ever. But, Lord, we pray that you would take this word that has gone forth. You would take it to the hearts of your people. Cause understanding to come. Cause revelation to come. Cause light to shine in their hearts. And I pray that you would minister your life to your people and bless every family represented here today. Oh, Lord, we give you praise. We give you thanks. We give you honor. We give you glory for that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Now, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. We bless you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. I want you to know that we are very happy and pleased and blessed for those who were here today, those who joined us by way of live stream, thank you. And those who will pick it up later, thank you. We appreciate that. Greet one another. Let your brothers and sisters here today, that are here today, know that you appreciate them and love them. Pardon me. And just be blessed. Amen.
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 Yeah.